This is an expose of an organisation called Hope Not Hate. You're going to witness allegations of blackmail, sexual assault, providing drugs to sources of information in order to get them to say something, paying people tens of thousands of pounds. When you get your media reports or see on documentaries people speaking about us, you see a source of information. What I'm going to do is give evidence and show you how those sources are created. The BBC, Channel 4, they can't blackmail people. They can't offer money to people. In steps the Dirty Tricks Brigade of the British establishment, Hope Not Hate. They come in, they take a source, they approach people, everyone they approach around you. They offer money, they offer drugs, whatever it takes in order to get them to say what they say. When they say what they want them to say, or they lie, these guys publish it to the world. The problem is that they're taken as reliable sources because Hope Not Hate's reputation carries weight. They're in with your politicians, they're supported by all the political parties. By the end of this documentary, you're going to question every source of information that you see from this point on. In this documentary, you're going to hear a lot about Hope Not Hate. It's important you understand who they are. Hope Not Hate is a so-called anti-fascist organisation who formed in 2004. They formed from a group and a magazine called Searchlight. Nick Lowles, who now leads Hope Not Hate, was a lead member of Searchlight. In 1984, Searchlight worked alongside Panorama to fraudulently edit footage which they were prosecuted or taken to court and sued for. They paid £1 million damages to Conservative MPs who they wrongfully edited footage to link them with far-right extremist groups. Hope Not Hate brand themselves as an anti-fascist organisation. They're there to tackle fascism. In reality, they label, slander and attack anyone who speaks out against open borders or against Islam. The worrying thing is they have a lot of influence. For example, all media outlets across the UK, across the world, take what they say as credible and they work hand in hand with them. From CNN, The Guardian, Huffington Post, The Independent, Sky News, Newsnight, Panorama, The Metro, The Sunday Times. They even advise the UN. They advise counter-terrorism. Just last year, Hope Not Hate were identified in a Swedish military report on left-wing extremist violence. It has been proven that Hope Not Hate exaggerated hate crime figures by 3,000%. Nothing they said after that point should ever have been taken as credible, let alone taken by journalists without checking anything and spread around the world to demonise and slander people and organisations. They play a key role in pressurising social media giants, whether it be with petitions or requests from MPs that they're working alongside with, to say who's promoting hate. Not who's promoting hate that would breach laws in this country, but who needs silencing with their opinion? They're now teaching your children in schools about fascism. If we take a quote from their original spin doctor, Dan Hodges, from his quote, you'll understand the tactics they use in this documentary. It was a no holds barred bare knuckle PR. We used every dirty, underhand, low down, unscrupulous trick in the book. These are quotes from their spin doctor, Joe Mulhell, who is a lead researcher for Hope Not Hate. He brags about days out with their BBC political reporters. Their relationship works hand in hand with the corrupt mainstream media. They do the reports, the media then use their ammunition and their labelling to attack people and organisations, to demonise them and slander them. In 2015, Joe Mulhell used the hashtag Antifa on several occasions. The reason why this is so relevant is when you understand who Antifa are. Antifa are an organisation that leading members of the American government have called to be prescribed as a terrorist organisation. They balaclava up, they mask up, and they violently attack people who they're told to attack, and organisations which are highlighted to them by groups and organisations like Hope Not Hate. They find out who you are, they contact your work, anyone who steps above the parapet. Hope Not Hate's goal is to silence them and stop them. This is about stopping free speech. This is about having people too scared to speak. We'll speak with one gentleman now whose life has been completely changed due to him voicing his opinions. He broke no law, committed no crime. But wait till you hear what Hope Not Hate done to him.
This time last year, like I said, I was working full-time, happy, and because of some things I was doing outside of work, where I was sort of expressing my political opinions and so on, I ended up drawing their fire, and they wrote a report and called it in to the employer. So it was a kind of deliberate attempt to, it wasn't just to dox me because I hadn't hidden my name, I didn't think I was doing anything wrong, I was just expressing an opinion, but it was an attempt to deliberately get me fired.
Where was you working?
I was working at Standard Chartered Bank in Moorgate.
Doing what?
I was an associate, so I'd been there from a grad. I went to Bristol University and then went into the bank straight afterwards. So I've been there for about just around 18 months at this point.
So a good career.
Yeah, it was going well. Internally, there'd been no issues.
When you say you got involved, you was giving your political opinions with regards to?
Obviously, the controversial stuff. So immigration, Islam, these kind of issues, but not in an extreme way. Nothing you wouldn't happily say to anyone.
Just so we can get clear, we're not talking about committing a crime. We're just talking about speaking openly about immigration and Islam.
Yeah, and no one had a problem with it. That's the whole point that kind of strikes me about it.
So it's not like anyone made a complaint, nothing's happened. So what did Hope Not Hate do?
So Hope Not Hate, one of their, I can't remember which, but a team of their researchers wrote a small report. They were calling up multiple offices at the bank, and they were also focusing, because obviously we have a very big presence in the Middle East. So they were focusing on offices there to call them and just basically say, you've got this guy working for you, he's an Islamophobe, he's a racist, blah, 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 all of which obviously isn't true. I remember I was just sitting at my desk and I get called in by the MD and he sort of says, have you been saying this? And I say, yeah, no, I have. I didn't see it as a problem. The same guys were going to a lot of journalists trying to flog this report as well to make a big story out of it. Eventually, in around the summer of last year, you get this article and it's very vicious and it's obviously largely lifted from the report that came out a few weeks earlier, you know, using slurs, using kind of nonsense labels, calling us Nazis, all that kind of thing.
Calling you Nazis with any evidence?
Was there no evidence to anything whatsoever, you've said? At all. It was made up with a very clear intention of making me lose my job. And it's a common tactic.
And you did lose your job?
Yeah, I was suspended, and then once the coverage happened, they obviously, whilst previously, like internally, the bank, I think, had kind of thought, well, maybe this is just an attack piece. Once there was coverage, obviously, it's their reputation on the line. So then, pretty much immediately, I was fired.
Just to let the public understand this, you committed no crime.
No crime.
You speak, outside of work, about immigration or Islam, with no hatred.
No hatred.
Just facts. And because of that, where are you now? How's your life changed? What do you see for your future now?
Financially very difficult, of course, because it kills your income. And then there's knock-ons from that that are always a pain.
Okay, well, thanks, and I hope you... I wish you luck and try and get your life sorted.
Me too.
Yeah, good luck.
Thank you.
So Hope Not Hate are the dirty tricks brigade of the British establishment. This is Nick Knowles. Nick Knowles is the main face and the head of the organisation. Matthew Collins, Joe Mulhall. First of all, we'll rewind 2 years. I've already exposed this organisation. This is Caelan Robertson. Caelan Robertson is an ex-employee of mine. They got into him. They blackmailed him. He was sexually assaulted, he was threatened, he was intimidated, he was scared, and they created him into a source of information. So they forced him to say negative things about me so the media could print them to the world. You're going to hear that story now.
We were basically threatened with the most horrendous shit you can possibly imagine for 3 months, constantly, to do this. Constantly. Because basically, why they have dirt on us is when we left Rebel... I don't know if I told you this. When we left Rebel, we were really fucking angry, and none of the media would take all the stuff we had on them. So Nick Lowe's reached out to me on Twitter, and he was like, oh, meet up with us. And we were like, oh, okay, like, we weren't working with anyone then. So we were like, yeah, fuck it. And we met up with them twice, and we were like, oh, we can write a book on Rebel Media. We can write a book on how they've scammed people and this and this and this and this and this. And we were like really conniving with them. One of the first things they started threatening us with, this only started 3 months ago. We had no contact with them between 3 months ago and leaving Rebel, nothing. They started messaging us saying, we need to meet you. This is really serious. And then when we met them, they said to George, I wasn't there. We're going to release all of the meetings that you've had with us, threatening Rebel Media and talking shit about right-wing personalities and bitching about them. Nothing serious, just saying, oh, they're cunts. And they're going to make you, and we're going to basically expose you. And also, we've got 6 signatures from the top trade unionist organizations in the country saying that they're going to come after you, and the government have opened a new department which we're advising on counterterrorism, which are going to prosecute you for writing scripts which have incited the Darren Osborne terrorist attack. And it was like they were basically like, you're going to fucking go to jail and you're going to get exposed for meeting with us if you don't work with us. This is what it all comes down to, this panorama fucking thing. And Hope Not Hate were there, standing next to the BBC producers.
When you went for the meeting on Panorama, who from Hope Not Hate was there?
Nick, Joe, John Sweeney, and the producer. So, like,
hope not hate, were like fucking terrifying, and they like did, you know, they blackmailed us. They found, like, Joe fucking used the whole thing to try and get into Kaylin's pants.
This is how bad it really was. When we pulled up in London, this was the day that I dropped off the suitcase to you, right? That I went straight off from there, I can't remember where it was, to go and do this interview with them. They hired out this big car park warehouse thing. They had a little chair in the middle of it. I walked into this room, sat down. It was a cameraman, it was the head producer, it was Nick, and it was Joe. And then I started getting really nervous because she was saying, how much money, name numbers, name figures. And I was like, well, it was enough to pay for us to make videos, and all the money was spent on it. And I was just saying vague shit. And then Joe said, can we stop the interview, please? And then I was like, okay. And then Nick went, can you come with us, Kaylin? And then Nick and Joe took me to the other side of the warehouse and said, Kaylin, you really need to give them more information than this. You really need to open up a little bit more, because this is really not useful to them. They're probably not even going to use this. You need to go into specifics. You need to go into numbers. You need to at least show them something.
Were they threatening you?
Have a cigarette and we'll come back to it.
Were they threatening you then?
Okay. I had a cigarette and I went back and I sat down and I still couldn't really do it. And it was really bad. Like, I was like shaking the whole time. That's when we told Panorama that we didn't feel that it was safe, that it was not okay, and that we were basically threatened.
Bit of a strange one here, yeah?
Wait a minute.
I know, sorry, man. It's 4 o'clock in the morning here, but I've just got off the phone to Kaylin for an hour, yeah? How much have they told you about Hope Not Hate?
Not much, why?
You're aware they've been meeting with them regularly.
I've met Joe too before. Yeah, I know that Kaylin and George have met with them before.
Continually met with them? When you was doing your borderless documentary, Hope Not Hate flew out to Italy to meet them?
I don't know what they were talking about, but for the most part, like, I think they're just afraid of them. From what I've been told, it's like they're like, oh, they're kind of blackmailing us, like, hang out with us or else we're going to get you guys arrested or whatever. So they just met with them.
So hold on a second. I work for Panorama. Yeah. What happened was, they were Hope Not Hate present in an interview with Kaylin Robertson? I work for Panorama. And we are doing a film about you.
Are you aware of that? Look at me.
Yes. I'm the reporter and I'm asking you a question.
Okay.
Right, I get the point.
Are you aware? Are you aware of indecent images sent by someone from Home I Hate to Kaylin Robertson?
I'm aware of the allegation.
You are aware.
I'm aware of an allegation, and I do not think it credible or serious. If I'm wrong, you can put that information out there.
If somebody has been blackmailed, threatened, intimidated by an organisation that is steering your documentary...
It's not serious.
Okay, can we hear the next one? Play the next bit.
Made. Really inappropriate. I don't know how to describe it. Almost basically a sexual assault situation towards me when I was really drunk, pretty much passed out.
Fuck you, now this gets messier and messier.
No, hold on, yeah, okay, and I got really upset and I broke down and I told George about it last week because it's really fucked me up. And George messaged Nick and apparently nearly got suspended and it's a really big mess.
What's come to Milan to see you? Who'd he come with?
Nick.
He come with Nick, so Nick was with him. And what did he do when he was drunk?
Nick wasn't there at that moment. Yeah. Nick had gone home.
So we were filming with Lauren, and then they said, like, you've got to meet us. So we flew to Spain via Milan, met them in Milan, literally just had a coffee with them, where they basically just carried on threatening us, and said, you've got to do, like, Sky or one mainstream media thing. And then I went back to London to drop something off and to go then to Spain. So Kaylin was left in Milan for one night. Nick left that night as well, I think. And then this is when this thing happened. Kaylin said that he was basically really wasted, that he thinks let himself into Kaylin's room. And basically, yeah, Kaylin kind of woke up and was like half naked, like trying to do stuff with him, and then Kaylin said no, and was like, oh, you don't have to tell anyone, blah 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 blah. Kaylin's like really fucked up about it. So this was like 3 months ago, or 2 months ago, and Kaylin only told me about it last week. So I messaged Nick saying, like, we need to talk, what the fuck is going on?
And then Nick said that he's like doing an investigation into it. George also messaged Panorama saying, guys, Hope Not Hate raped Kaylin.
Now listen to this recording that was released just this week of Kaylin Robertson, who's now a journalist for Byline Times, and George Llewellyn John, who's my ex-colleague. Listen to the allegations they are making. The British state. This is what Hope Not Hate did to them.
They're all gearing up to say, if we take down those boys, then the Tommy Robertson will never happen again. Joe said there was a meeting that took place recently where they had three files on the table, and it was Tommy Robertson, Kaylin Robertson, and George. Everything we've ever done, our birth records, every hospital visit we've ever been to, every psychiatric, every au pair we've ever had, everything you could possibly imagine. Shit from when I was like 10 years old from another country. And they had all these files, and they were like, the hammer has to fall on one of these people, and who allowed this to happen?
It's like they're literally sitting there with the files and a hammer going.
Yeah, like, that's how fucking serious it is. And I'm not
to a point where if we carried on with Tommy, say he didn't go to prison and we carried on with him for another 3 months, we would probably be in prison by Christmas.
This organisation's job is to create sources of information. They don't go as journalists and find a source and interview them normally. They create a source, as you've seen, through blackmail. But it's not just Kaylin. We will prove to you, source after source after source, against different individuals, not just myself, have been created. Once they create their source and their source pumps the lie that they want them to tell, the mainstream media are waiting. They then take that story and they pump it to you, the British public. You don't know what's gone on behind the scenes. You literally get the newspaper or the news article or the documentary. They work with Panorama. They work with dispatches. They work with everyone. Let's listen to what Joe Mulhall had to say when I asked about his involvement and his presence during the filming of Panorama against myself.
Hello.
Hi, Joe. It's Tommy Robinson.
Oh, hi there. How's it going?
Yeah, not bad. Obviously, you're aware I have a documentary coming out on Saturday. I'd just like to just ask you a couple of questions quickly about your involvement.
Bear with me. I'm not going to be able to do it over the phone, I'm afraid. Yeah. I'd have to speak to colleagues before I can do anything, I'm afraid.
So you can't just answer why you were... Were you present during an interview with Kaylin Robertson and Panorama?
I'm not going to be able to talk about anything on the phone.
Yeah, why not? Why not?
You can't just ring someone up. If you want to speak to me, you can drop me an email and you can...
This is just your opportunity to counter what's being said.
I'm not going to answer any questions over the phone, although I don't see what's the issue there is, even if I was.
So, were you and Nick Knowles present during an interview of Kaylin Robertson and Panorama?
Well, I've said everything I'm going to say to you, Tommy. I'm not going to answer any questions like that. If you want
just
to
a yes or no. It's just it's a simple yes or no.
Simply, look, Tommy, we're wasting time here.
Okay.
So. Now listen to what happened when I approached the producers of Panorama to ask them the simple question. Were Hope Not Hate steering your documentary?
Okay, well, you're in trouble as well. You're all in trouble.
You're all in trouble. We invited you for an interview today. Yep. You haven't given us an interview.
No, I haven't. I've exposed you, okay? You were trying to destroy my life. You have been contacting people. Why were Hope Not Hate present? Why were the leaders of a far-left George Soros-funded organisation, why were they present during the interview of a person which you were goading to give bad information about me? Why were they present? Tell me. If this is a Panorama documentary, why were Hope Not Hate present?
This is an ongoing documentary.
This is an establishment attack on me and your part of it. And you've been exposed to the world tonight.
This is Jim Dowson. Many, including the media, say that he is the brains behind many organisations who are labelled as far right. He's a money raiser. He does the work in the background. I was invited to a meeting with Jim in 2015, literally hours after the meeting ended. These headlines were pumped around the world. Literally within hours of that meeting, Jim Dowson, who openly admits this, had contacted Nick Knowles, he'd give them the story, and they were pumping this story around the world. So I've been very aware since 2015 that Jim Dowson, so-called patriot from Northern Ireland, is in bed with Hope Not Hate. Okay, so when I see Jada Frantzen, who was Paul Golden's partner in Britain First. Both of them were put in prison for their activism. They went to a paedophile's house, who is now convicted and got 20 years in jail, and they questioned him when they knocked on the door. They both got custodial sentences. Jada comes out of jail and literally straight away teams up with Jim Dowson. That was concern bells for me, because I know Jim Dowson is in bed with Hope Not Hate. Literally within 2 months of her coming out of jail, I saw a Panorama documentary in Northern Ireland with Jada Frantzen on it. Listen to what she says.
We've spoken to a number of ex-members of Britain First. They also said there were times when they would go out and Paul would lock you in the house until they came back. Is that true?
Yeah. This was my normality. This was my day-to-day existence, was just complete control, I guess, or being controlled, I guess. It was like I just accepted that that was what he was going to do, that I couldn't, if they went out and he'd lock me in the house.
Now, you have to understand what was happening at this time in Northern Ireland. Britain First were making inroads. They were the only political organisation who were taking to the streets, getting people out on the streets and raising awareness of the Islamification and what the problems that come with Islam. They're the only party talking about it. And for that, they must be silenced. In step, Hope Not Hate. Now, we know that in 1984, Searchlight, the organisation that then turned into Hope Not Hate, had to pay £1 million because of the stitch-up and hatchet job they were doing with Panorama against Conservative MPs. £1 million in 1984. We know, and I've proved to you, that just a couple of years ago, the Hope Not Hate were working with Panorama to stitch me up. So when I see a Panorama documentary with Jada Franson, whose right-hand man is in bed with Hope Not Hate, it rings alarm bells. I was also aware that Jada Franson was close associates with Johnny Mad Dog Adair. This is her in his house with her dog. They were close. This is who Johnny Mad Dog Adair is.
Johnny Mad Dog Adair is living in exile in Scotland, looking to come out of retirement.
Do surrender!
For 20 years, he directed more than 40 killings and hundreds of attempted murders as his notorious C company terrorised the Catholics of Northern Ireland.
Now, what has changed? Paul Golding and Jada Franson were inseparable. They were both leaders of Britain First. Everywhere he went, she went. She comes out of custody with 8 weeks. She's sitting on Panorama slamming Paul Golding. Now, straight away, my suspicions are, because I know they're always lurking in the background, especially with Panorama. And to see such a change overnight. Now, I know a link with Johnny Mad Dog Adair. I managed to get his phone number. And I thought I'd put in a phone call and see what he knows. Let me just ring Johnny Adair. He's going to think, what? I've heard he was...
Hello?
Hello, Johnny. It's Tommy Robinson.
Okay, how are you, Tommy?
I'm all right, mate. I'm all right. This is good. No, thanks, buddy. I just, Johnny, this is going to seem like a weird one, yeah? I'm looking at, I'm just querying. I heard that you was talking to Jim Dowson, yeah? The timeline is Jada Franson, there was a documentary, a Panorama documentary.
Yeah, I remember it.
You remember it?
Yes, and how long ago back? 2 years? See, I don't know. Yeah. And that was the last time I spoke to Jim Dowson. And to be honest, it was more sympathetically from my point of view, because Jada and Paul had their differences. But I mean, I respect for both of them, and I think that both of them done a great job. But their fallout was their fallout and was none of my business. But I felt she's living back over in Northern Ireland, and I felt that the chips was down for her, and she hadn't 2 days, and life was bad. And when I spoke to Dowson, I remember saying, look, I would want to give her a couple of pounds to get the nation. And he said, no, she's already, she got 20,000 pounds there. I put in the bank that was the time of the
Panorama. So you rang up to offer some money or to offer.
I'm not sure whether he rang me or I rang him. Okay. One of the two, but the conversation was my intentions. It would have been me probably ringing him. My intentions was to give her a donation to try and help her because I did feel sorry for her. Now I hadn't seen or spoken to her in some time, but okay. I was reading and hearing stories that she was in hard times, but then I heard that she was with Dowson and them two were obviously working together. So when I contacted him, I said, look, listen, I'm hearing all these stories about Jada. I says, like, I would like to give her a few quid, like, as a donation. And he turned around, he says, no, she's already, she got £20,000 there.
She's got £20,000, and the timing of this was just prior to the Panorama.
That was around about that time, yep, yep. And I didn't question. I was happy once he says his £20,000. I mean, well, that's in the result. I said, well, that's good. So I didn't need to pursue my conversation
anymore.
No,
that's... Yeah, no.
Giving her a donation.
Okay.
But that was my intentions, and that's what he told me.
Okay, cool. No, because it's just... I know Jim Dowson works with Hope Not Hate. I knew that 6-7 years ago. So we just...
He would work with anybody but him, wouldn't he?
Anyone that give him money. Yeah, so I'm just doing an investigation, and everywhere I'm looking, Hope Not Hate are there, involved with Panorama, involved with politicians, and there's money. In fact, £20,000 that you say is the same figure that I've got covert recordings was offered to another gentleman to lie.
That's what he told me. Like,
he told you.
I'm no grapes to fucking quite fucking by saying that. It was an innocent conversation I had referenced me wanting to give her a donation.
Okay.
And it was to get through him, because obviously I had no contact with her. I hadn't spoke to her since she had the fallout. I never had a fallout with her.
No, I felt really
sorry. Me, hard, me, loyal.
No, so did I. So did I, buddy. So did I, because I thought Jade had done some great... Until I knew she was with Dowson, and then I knew that's Hope Not Hate. I knew it.
So there you have it. Out of jail, down on her luck, receives £20,000. Not according to me, according to her friend, Johnny Adair. Receives £20,000. And then is on Panorama documentary slamming Paul Golden. Let's have a look who else took part in that same Panorama documentary. It's a well-oiled machine.
This was my day-to-day existence, was just complete.
That's why most people now advertise through social media and not in the newspapers.
Britain First is Paul Golden, and Paul Golden will flog and sell. So who's being interviewed? Jim Dowson, Matthew Collins of Hope Not Hate, and their new created source of information, who has received tens of thousands of pounds, who's always lurking in the background, creating these sources, Hope Not Hate. What do you get, the British public, sitting at home? You get a Panorama documentary which makes these allegations from a female about Paul Golden. You don't get who they are, how they operate, and the fact that tens of thousands of pounds have been handed over. These tactics are used against anyone who speaks up against open border immigration. They've been used against me for years. But at this present moment, we're looking at Paul Golden's Britain First. They're making inroads into Northern Ireland. And for that, the agents of the state, Hope Not Hate, they must step in and they must be silenced. Whilst we're looking at Hope Not Hate and Paul Golden and Britain First, I'm gonna stay on Britain First. Let me introduce you to Andrew Edge. Andrew Edge was the main security person for Paul Golden. They were together everywhere for years. Everywhere Paul went, Andrew Wedge went. Now we've seen what's changed Jada Frampton from years of loyalty to overnight, total 360 change with outlandish allegations. Let's just listen to this covertly recorded conversation with Andrew Wedge.
What are you, mate? I'll tell you that anyway.
What?
The what out on
you, mate? Who wants to go out on me?
That fucking nut more than anybody, you know what I'm on about, don't you? Matthew. And that folks, I've met him as well, fucking idiots. I've been in the hotel in London, mate.
This is an operation. Hope Not Hate approach everyone around you, everyone close to you, anyone you have a falling out with, they approach. It's a machine. It's how they create their sources of information against people. I know this better than most. One of the people Hope Not Hate approached close to me was my mum's brother. He came to see me. He said, I can't be painting walls. He's a painter and decorator. I can't be painting walls for the rest of my life. I'm getting old. Basically telling me that he's gonna work with them. Yeah? He come to me for his permission. We haven't spoke since, but I know who they approach, and how they get in with them, yeah? How they work their way in. Now you're gonna listen to a conversation. Paul Golden, as soon as he found out Andrew Edge, his right hand security, had been talking liaison or meeting with Hope Not Hate, he expelled him straight away. You're now gonna hear a conversation between Paul Golden and Andrew Edge, where you hear the details of what Hope Not Hate were planning on doing to Paul Golden.
Now, do you remember, so they've said to you they haven't got no evidence, but they want you to stand up in court. Dirty cunts.
Exactly.
Is that what they've said, yeah?
Yeah, pretty much. They're going to pick me up, mate. They're not even thinking with Jada at the minute. Because fucking Jada's ass was just demanding too much.
She's demanding too much.
Say again?
She's demanding too much.
Yeah, she was asking for too much.
The thing is, there's fuck all they can get me on anyway, the cheeky fucks.
Well, a woman from the office has been there.
What, and they want you to set me up?
Yeah, £20,000-£30,000
So there you have it. Andrew Edge, £20,000 offered to him by Hope Not Hate. That's the exact same amount that Johnny Adair says Jada Fanson received just before she comes star witness in a big documentary that you're all watching at home against Paul Golding. Andrew Edge offered £20,000. He admits he's been receiving money from Hope Not Hate.
I said, I've got nothing to hide. You have. You've been working with the police, the Home Office, Hope Not Hate.
Will I ever work with the police? No. Have I worked with Hope Not Hate? Yes.
Well, yeah, he's a cunt, and you work with Hope Not Hate, the Home Office, yes. And the police.
Hello, they give me £300 today, by the way.
That's nice.
This is Hope Not Hate's job as agents of the state. They step in where the BBC, the Daily Mail can't, okay? The BBC can't pay you for news. They cannot pay people to take part in any documentaries. They cannot pay you for interviews. The reason being, once you pay someone money, they will say whatever you want them to say. They're no longer a reliable source. Since Andrew Edge, as we hear, began getting paid by Hope Not Hate, they created a source of information. He then makes allegations against Paul Golding, having hundreds of thousands of pounds or receiving lots of money and having it in Russia. He hasn't just made allegations against Paul Golding. He's made allegations against me. News stories have been pumped about me from their new source of information, Andrew Edge. So they come in, they create the sources, say what they want them to say. You don't know any of this. You're just getting a source says. Little do you know that source is blackmailed, threatened, or being paid. Now, while we're on, I could do this about every organisation, every activist, every political activist that's come under attack by these guys. But whilst we're on Paul Golding and Britain First, I'm going to stay there. Let's have a look at Tom Foley. I've never met Tom Foley. I had no idea who he was until I started my investigation into their corruption. Tom Foley was a homeless veteran living on the streets. He was taken off the streets by Paul Golding, brought into his home, and just listen to what Tom Foley, not me, listen to what comes out of the horse's mouth in his views on Paul Golding and his family.
I have gone from sleeping in the tent, I met Paul Golding. Listen to me, Jamie, you're listening to me.
Yeah, I'm listening to you.
I love you, bro.
Yeah.
I love you. I love your mum. I love your missus. I love Paul. I tell you what, I love Paul for what he's done, what he's doing. You're fucking angels. You, Holly, and your mother, Paul, Andy, and all of you, you're fucking angels. You're not devils. You're fucking angels. How the fuck would I have got through what I've been through without you?
You've heard his opinion on Paul Golding. The man was welcomed into the organisation and travelled everywhere with them. Now, what is it that changes that opinion to this?
I was outside Lincoln City for 2 weeks and my wife ran down A1, so you never picked her off the street. You barged in on a protest, what I were protesting, me. On my own, not you. And then he changed it all about you and you balls all that up. Well, you didn't balls it up, you did it on purpose because you were robbing me. You kept me there. Instead of going in like I was meant to, you kept me there so you could earn this. You're telling people that you give me £1,500 to disappear. No, mate. You've got 15 grand of mine in a bank account, Paul. 15,000 quid. You got 16 and a half grand for me. You owe me 15 grand. Yeah. Don't be telling people you sent me on my way with 1,500 quid.
What is it that changes it? Now, let's look at the first person to share Tom Foley's negative comments on Paul Golding. It's Matthew Collins from Hope Not Hate. Now, what's changed? What's happened? Well, it's very similar to what's happened here, 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 and now here. Let's listen to a conversation from Tom Foley.
Have you met Hope Not Hate by any chance?
Fucking hell.
Have you
yeah,
met,
last week.
You've met Hope Not Hate?
Yeah.
So you've met Hope Not Hate?
Yeah.
Did they reach out to you or did you reach out to them?
Yeah, they reached out to me. Come and stop at my house. I went to their house for one night. Got me stoned.
Yeah, of course, yeah. Peddled
you with... Put in my pocket. Paid for my train ticket there. Paid for my train ticket away. And I come away.
So there you have it.
You heard it. They bought drugs for Tom Foley. Tom Foley was homeless because he suffered from mental health and addiction issues. When you get someone like Tom Foley, which is what Hope and the Hate have done, they've contacted him, they've paid his travel, they've put him up, they've gave him drugs, they've given him money. Now, when you give an addict drugs and money, they'll say whatever you want them to say and waiting ready to pump it to the world, them and the media. This is simply proving to you how Hope Not Hate operate. This, I'm presenting it. This isn't my opinion. I'm giving you evidence. These are covert recordings of not one, not two, not three, four, and will continue to people who are admitting that this is how they operate, whether it be drugs, blackmail, sexual assault, tens of thousands of pounds. They create the source of information that the mainstream media are sat working hand in hand with them. They're working together and they're ready to pump it to you, to lie to you, to create negative views of certain people. In my discussions with Paul Golding during my investigation, he was under the opinion that something had to be done. Their actions are criminal. Paying tens of thousands of pounds and asking someone to lie in court is a criminal offence. Giving drugs to people to get them high in order to get them into position and give them money as well to get them to say certain things about people is a criminal offence. Paul told me to meet up with him because he was going to do something about it. I went to meet him to see what was happening.
So, Paul, tell me what we're doing here. We're outside Bexhead Police Station, South East London. I've got a pre-arranged interview, an appointment with someone from CID. They've told me to come down about 7:30, which is Iran time. I'm handing in a witness statement and I've got a USB stick here, which contains multiple clips of two phone conversations which implicate Hope Not Hate in criminal offences, specifically Matthew Collins and Nick Lowles. And these offences range from conspiracy to commit perjury, perverting the course of justice and the supply of basically class B drugs or something like that. So I'm going to speak to them and hopefully they'll launch a criminal investigation against Hope Not Hate.
What? Police officer for an hour and a half. They said they found an officer, that was an hour ago.
Okay, I'll check it.
You can double check for us, yeah?
Do you think Nick Lowles would be waiting an hour and a half for an appointment?
No, definitely not.
They'd go pick him up. They'd go pick him up from his house and bring him in.
Yeah.
And send a chauffeur.
I know.
Mental, innit?
We expect this though, double standards. Sorted.
Yeah?
What did you say? So, in a nutshell, that was in there quite a long time, wasn't I?
Yeah, it was ages.
So we went through my statement. We went through all of the audio clips. They said they're going to go and investigate the whole thing. They said they're going to speak to Andy Edge.
Yeah.
They said they're going to speak to Tom Foley. They said they're going to speak to Jada Franson. They all seem to be implicated in this. They all, whether it's drugs or perverting the course of justice or something like that, they said they're going to go away and speak to those people and say to them, look, you said this. Yeah, is this true?
Because if it's true, it's a court case.
If it's true, they...
Why would they lie?
Well, what exactly? Why would they lie? Why would they make up such elaborate things?
Yeah. All about the same organisation?
Yeah, about the same two people, Matthew Collins and Nick Lowles, both mentioned by name on those audio recordings. And they said that the offences are perverting the course of justice, conspiracy to commit perjury and supply of drugs. It's all there.
Yeah.
And audio evidence. They go and speak to the people, put it in front of them. If I had an audio recording of you saying XYZ and they put that to you in an interview, you wouldn't have a leg to stand on, would you? You'd have to admit it.
It's the same as the audio recordings from Panorama, where they were blackmailing two of my old employees.
Yeah.
Which I clearly were.
So they said they're going to go away. He said, I'm going to go away now and speak to these people.
Okay.
We're going to speak to them and we're going to interview them. They said they emailed me the crime reference number literally, you know, by tonight.
So they've opened a criminal investigation?
They've opened a criminal investigation into Hope Not Hate, specifically Matthew Collins and Nick Lowles.
Well, they need it.
Yeah.
They need it.
Because in the past they've taken money, taxpayers' money, and they tout themselves as this squeaky clean anti-racist group. But really, they're involved in criminality. They're trying to stitch people up using illegal criminal means.
Well, they're doing what...
So I was going to go gym, but that's changed. Because last week, we went with Paul Golding to report Hope Not Hate for some crimes. I know he's had a mad week, and his family have had a mad week. But I just watched a video of Greater Manchester Police coming to his house and telling him that his life's now in danger. And so is his partner's life in danger. So we're going to shoot straight up north. We're going to see Paul, see his family, and find out what's been going on. Because it seems last week, Hope Not Hate reported, and I know there's a lot gone on this week involving Hope Not Hate and the targeting of Paul's family. So we're going to go see what's going on.
So, well, thanks for letting me in.
No problem.
I just want to ask you a few questions
about
recent activities with regards to Hope Not Hate. I obviously went with your partner to London, where he made an official complaint, a legal complaint to the police about their actions. Am I right that in the same week you had a visit from the police?
Yeah. It was just around 5 or 6 days later. I got a knock on the door and it was Greater Manchester Police's safeguarding unit. And as soon as you hear safeguarding unit, you know something's up. So I allowed them in and they spoke to Paul and myself in the living room and they said, there's been a credible death threat to you, do you know? So we need to pick take precautions. We need you to know, do you know? We'll get the fire unit out.
Right, what it is, like I say, I work in a safeguarding unit and we deal with things along the lines of threats to life.
Okay. Yes.
We've received some information that there's a risk to yourself, okay?
Okay.
My DI has had a look at this and he has deemed that this risk is quite significant. So he's asked me to come round and issue you with a threat to life warning notice.
Okay.
As you can see here, I've got, you know, a safety guide that Greater Manchester Fire and Rescue Service gave me because our lives were in, you know, danger.
So they believe, when they say in danger, they're giving you a fire safety. They believe that someone's going to possibly, or they're telling you someone's going to firebomb your house.
Well, that's what this is said, telling. Yeah. When the firemen came round, they said, you know, you're at real risk of petrol bombs coming through your door. They told us to lock up our wheelie bins outside with chains.
You don't get them near the house.
Yeah, so don't get them near the house because the flames go straight up. They put a letterbox guard on the front door. They checked all the fire alarms and had a lengthy discussion with me about what to do in case of, you know, a fire.
So how long have you lived here?
6 years.
6 years. Your partner's been involved in politics for longer than that.
Yeah, of course.
He's had some high moments as well.
Yeah.
All in the media. High opposition to him at times. Have you ever had any threat of this house?
Never.
So all of those key moments of Paul's career or Paul's life, you've never had any trouble here?
Only when it related to Hope Not Hate around 18 months ago. There's been two incidents here and both have related to Hope Not Hate, you know, and who they've funded.
Yeah. Addy, you're full of shit.
Are you listening? Yes, I'm going to kill your brother.
Okay. And then, so they come round. What's that? You've got a child that lives here?
Yes, I've got a young son that lives here.
How old's your son?
He's 13.
So you've obviously, have you had to talk to him about this?
Yeah, well, when this first happened, when we got the knock on the door on the Friday, I was advised by them to get my son out of the house just because there is an imminent threat. So I actually had to get my son to stay at a relative's house for a few days because of the threat, you know, that we was under. So I had to explain everything to him because he didn't want to stay out that weekend. So unfortunately, you know, I have to make him aware.
Now, I've just walked in here, I've seen cameras everywhere.
Yeah.
I've seen a letterbox so no one can put nothing through the letterbox. Yeah. What's that feel like in your home?
Well, it doesn't feel good because this should be my sanctuary. This should be my safe place. You know, when most people go home, they lock the door and they're safe. Whereas I don't know who's going to turn up. I don't know whether I've got a scorned neighbour because of Hope Not Hate or Islamist or anyone that's going to turn up, do you know, and attack this house.
Can we, so the police come and visit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then 24 hours later.
Yeah.
Can you explain to me then what happens?
Yeah. 24 hours later, I was made aware from a friend of mine that lives a few streets away that there's leaflets going through letterboxes about Paul and about Britain First, about us being sympathisers to Russia. And I found out that from my friend, but then I spoke to neighbours, I spoke to several people on the estate, and everyone had got one, everyone.
And I'm right, because I saw online Paul went and found the men delivering the leaflets.
Yes, well, we was out that day anyway, and Paul just happened to stumble across them and approach them. And as usual, they had nothing to say. They had to put out these leaflets that put my family in danger, my son in danger. Yeah,
and then the man the man actually delivering them on camera has been found, recognised as an employee of Playmate.
Yes, yeah, of course.
And let me just, in this leaflet that's gone out, it says that your partner has hidden money in Russia to avoid paying tax.
It's just not true. If we were tax evading, we would have been arrested by now.
When this went out, just so the public understand, this was at the height. I know Ukraine war has been a big story for the British public and the news and the media. This was the highest moment of it, am I right? It was when the sanctions first come in.
Yeah, this was when Roman Abramovich was being sanctioned, when he had to step down as Chelsea boss. This was when it was at its height. So to put this leaflet out at that time was to put us in immense danger, because people felt so strongly about the war in Ukraine.
And they leafleted every single person where you live.
Every single person.
So Paul goes to the police station, makes a complaint. 5 days later, police are at the door, your life's in danger. The next day, just so then... It must have took a week to make a leaflet. By the time you plan one, write this. Okay. By the time you write this, plan this.
Yeah.
So literally, as soon as he's gone to the police and they're aware of it, because he's gone online and let them know there's an investigation into you, you've been targeted in your home.
Yeah, of course. As soon as they could produce the leaflet and get the manpower, they were straight here. They went straight to this estate. Do you know where I live? It's a big area. Yet they purposely only did the estate that I live on.
And the police have said?
The thing is, if you look at the sequence of events, it makes sense.
Yeah.
I go and report Hope Not Hate for criminal wrongdoing.
Yeah.
Literally a week later, they're in my vicinity, in my neighbourhood, delivering leaflets saying that I'm a tax cheat and that I'm Putin's stooge in the middle of the Ukraine war. It's almost like they're... Because of what I've done, reported to the police, their criminal wrongdoing, it's almost like I'm being bullied and targeted.
And it's all very malicious. The whole nature of it is, isn't it?
So wrong.
And it's the fact of, and that's the whole definition kind of a malicious communications, because the fact that it's untruthful, it doesn't matter. It's the fact of it's generating
the intention
this
action behind it. Do you know, because fair enough, disagree with us, are you right? But don't try and put people in harm's way.
Yeah, definitely. You know? And there's an expectation that you're never going to have everybody agree with you.
Yeah.
Everything.
That's life.
We get that as people anyway, don't we? Yeah. But there's a line, isn't there? And this is way over that.
Yeah, there are, like I said, there are other strands of this situation that are probably causing this Hope Not Hate a lot of consternation. The fact that one of the people they tried to give a lot of money to stitch me up in court, which is being investigated by Met Police, he's on trial in October for threats of violence, threats to kill, all that kind of stuff, threats of violence to us in this house. He actually came round and attacked this house.
Right.
But he's being prosecuted already for that.
Right. And again, is that...
The police said there's no other intention behind this than to cause distress, to cause harm, you know, to cause conflict. Because, as you know, say if my son's outside in the garden, who knows what will happen to him for simply being outside?
See, the frustrating thing for me with this is that people have a problem with me, but they shouldn't target the women and children.
Oh, of course not.
Which is essentially, by coming here, this is specifically aimed at to disrupt your life.
Of course, because what
better way... Has it disrupted yours and your child's life?
Oh, 100%. My son can't walk to school on his own, do you know? He has to be escorted to school by a family member. He can't just play out in the front garden anymore. He can't just walk to a local shop, because we don't know who else is going to target this house because of these smears. His life has been completely changed through this, do you know? And it's not fair, because he is not in politics. He didn't choose this.
And it's based on lies.
It's based on lies, fabrications.
And in response to?
In response to, Paul reporting them for criminality.
So we're looking at the tactics and the operation of Hope Not Hate. They're not just content with scaring, intimidating you or targeting you. They want to target your family. They want to target everyone around you. Now I'm just going to take you back to the covert recording with Andrew Edge. Let's listen to this.
Yeah, I even know the whole story. They then go on to your missus.
Yeah.
They've already made a few things on that. We're going to then fucking threaten her barbed wire, take the kid off her, so she doesn't carry on and bit first.
As you've heard, there he makes it very clear of Hope Not Hate's intention. Their intention is to use social services as a weapon against Ashley to get to Paul.
Yeah.
In there, he talks about Hope Not Hate discussing you and social services.
Yeah. This was about 18 months ago. Before we actually heard this recording, a few days before, I got a phone call from social services asking to come round and do an interview because they had heard a report that I was radicalising my son. And then as I thought, I don't know who this is, you know, that's made this report, but okay, I'll go ahead with it. And then a few days later, we come across this recording of Andrew Edge saying Hope Not Hate and using social services to target my child, and that's why I was investigated.
And it was, the recording was true?
Yeah, the recording was true because no one else knew that apart from myself and Paul, that I had had that call from social services a few days before.
And what did social services say?
Well, social services came around, they did an interview, they spoke with my son, his school, family members, everything. They concluded that it was a malicious report, that there's no evidence whatsoever to back up what the claim has been. And they said going forward, they'd put a note on their system.
To expect it.
To expect it and not to always, you know, do a thorough investigation unless there's proof, because they could see that this family was being targeted for the wrong reasons.
So Hope Not Hate again, social services to get to you. To get to your partner.
Yeah.
Because of his political opinion.
Of course, because obviously my life is my son. So that's who they're targeting, because obviously then I'd have that fear, they might take my son, so then I'd put pressure on Paul, to stop what he's doing, because I can't lose my child. Thankfully, to social services, that they actually saw what was happening and said, no, this is wrong,
These are such underhand tactics.
Yeah.
Being played against everyone.
It's disgusting, it's the lowest of the low. Who would go after children, if you disagree with someone?
Okay. All right. Well, thank you. Thanks for your time.
Not a problem. Thank you.
The targeting of Ashley in her home is nothing new. This is a pattern of abuse. They target women. They target children. They intimidate them in the one place they should feel safe, at home. Whilst we're looking at this, I want to tell you the story of Sharon Claff. Sharon Claff was a Jewish activist. She spoke out a couple of times about the building of a mega mosque, I believe, in London. And for that, she has to be silenced. What the point I want to make to you is, this isn't about just targeting Tommy Robinson or targeting Paul Golden. It's about targeting anyone who goes against the status quo that the establishment or the state needs silencing. They wrongfully lied and said Sharon Claff was part, this is a grandmother, yeah? A grandmother, an old age lady. They wrongfully lied and said that she was part of a far right organisation who took part in rushing a bookshop or something like that. Sharon Claff wasn't there. She never took part in anything. Yeah? She could prove that. Now, when she took them to court, Sharon Claff was in a position. Many of us aren't in a position to spend hundreds of thousands of pounds to take these organisations to court. Sharon Claff was. She used William Bennett QC, one of the best QCs in the country. Hope Not Hate accepted their guilt, because that's what it was. They admitted that they lied and they apologised. And I believe they paid £50,000. Let's have a look at the mainstream media and their reporting on this apology and this win for Sharon Claff against this organisation. As you can see, there's no mainstream media reporting at all on the fact that Nick Lowles' organisation lied, endangered the safety of a lady who had a cross put on her by Hope Not Hate. She was violently beaten in the street after wrongfully being accused of part of a far-right organisation. Not one mainstream media run it. The only media run it, the Jewish Chronicle. So proven to you, Hope Not Hate lie. You wouldn't have heard it in the media, of course, because it doesn't make media. They lie about old women and get them violently attacked. Not just content with targeting me, targeting my wife, targeting my children's home. They also target my mother's. My mother's been severely ill and my father is 74 years old. Yet they doxed their address, which resulted in their house being violently attacked and bricks thrown through the window in the middle of the night.
It's 1:30 in the morning. That's my mum's fucking windows.
That's my address. Shared it online. To his little hate mob. Yeah, I'll take that down. And how? And they're meant to have a mark on their address, yeah? They're meant to have a mark on their address because 24 hours ago, these bastards were ringing my ex-wife and my son. So police were at their house all day. A mark on the address, and I've just got here. There's no police here yet, even though they've rung the police instantly. When my fucking 74-year-old dad has been woken shitting himself in his bed because someone's smashing brick through his window. She said, because she told me today they've got a watch on your mum and dad's.
They've literally put it on while we've been driving here.
Oh no, she said, so my ex-partner must be speaking to police about what's gone on, and she's rang them to say...
This? I'm sorry you had to leave your family home at yesterday evening.
Yeah.
This morning it featured on our management meeting this morning. This job came up, and they're trying to apply the right amount of risk to it. Does that make sense?
Yes, yes.
The hate coming from this organisation continues and continues. It then resulted in men turning up looking for me at my mother's house. The neighbours spotted them outside videoing the property. Then I find out the same day that they were outside my mother's house, four Muslim men, had turned up at another property which had a young 12-year-old girl in. They turned up there looking for me. Why did they turn up at this house? Because Hope Not Hate had put this picture online alleging that it's my property. They're telling the public that I own this house. I don't own this house. I don't know the person that lived in this house. I do now, but I don't know the person that lived in this house. That this house is located near to my mother's house. When they put this article online with a picture of the house, they literally directed people, it's a hard house to find. They directed people, it's next door to this old people's home. They literally directed people so they could find it. And find it they did. Men turned up looking for me at this property, screaming and shouting multiple times. I'd heard men had been there. I went and approached the lady at the property to find out what's going on. Hi, are you on?
Yeah, morning.
I'm just chasing up what happened yesterday.
Yeah, well, I was out. Daughter rang me, crying. Car was on the drive. Asians were walking around the house. She was upstairs. Told her to stay on the phone to me, I was coming straight back. She was crying, I told her to go and take a picture of the car. She didn't want to take a car picture, she didn't want to go anywhere near it.
She got a good picture.
She did, only because she could hear them walking around the back because of the gravel. She knew it there at the back. She ran to the front of the house, took the picture and went back into the room, hiding under a quilt.
How old was your daughter?
12.
And you've rang the picture, just because they went to my mum's house yesterday as well, yeah? They was at my mum's house.
It's a joke.
I've got video of them. So I'm going to find out who they are today.
Right.
I'll know who they are today. But you had an incident last week as well.
Yeah, 2 weeks ago. It was a Saturday night. The car pulled up. Thought it was my boy coming to see me. Got the door and four Asians in the car. Asked me, where's Tommy? Where is he? Where's Tommy? Told him, I don't know who Tommy is. I live on there.
This is when we got in contact. This is when I got in contact. And you reported that to the police?
Reported it to the police. The police came round, told me to make sure the doors were locked, asked why it had started happening, and I said it's to do with that Hope Not Hate. Put it up on the internet.
So how long have you lived here?
Over a year now.
Have you ever had a problem here? So the problem started a few weeks ago?
A few weeks ago, two days after the Hope Not Hate put it on the internet. About you apparently opening this house.
This is my house.
No, it's not your house.
No, but they said this is my house.
They said it was your house, yeah.
So I looked, there's a picture of a van on the drive.
Yeah.
And then someone's put racist cunt.
Yeah.
I've got lots of things where I'm looking.
Yeah. That was my dad's van.
Oh, dad.
My lad's friend's van.
Okay. So.
With his number plate on it.
You live here?
I live here.
With your daughter?
Yeah.
She's how old again, sorry?
She's 12.
How is she?
Scared. She won't stay here when I know. I've got her now to hop over to my daughter's all the way in Dunstable before I can go to work today. Because I can't, she won't stay here. She won't stay here when I know anymore.
How are you?
Just shitting myself, I'm not going to lie. I don't want people coming down the drive.
What are you... I know, I'm not trying to... Like, I'm going to come... I'm going... I'll get today cameras. I'm meeting some lads.
Well, the police have said that they're going to secure the property for me to make sure that I keep the gate locked.
When did they say that?
Yesterday when they rode back.
Okay, they're going to... Because they come to my mum's last night and they left... And they just left. So... And I said, what are you going to do about it? Because have you got... Where's your letterbox?
I think my letterbox is around the other side of the door. Okay. I think it's because I'm already fleeing domestic violence. Because this was supposed to be the safe house for me, but now I'm even more scared.
So Nick Lowles, because I'm going to find him, do you want to come and speak to him?
Yeah, I will. I'd like to see how he feels about this. You know, like, we've already been terrorised once by my
ex-husband. He's got... What happened last time?
My ex-husband, like, yeah. That's why I've had my house petrol bombed by him. And now I'm getting this done. It's, you know, my little lady's shitting herself. She literally is shitting herself.
I find out that the lady in this house is a vulnerable victim. She's actually hiding. She's an ex-battered wife, whose ex-partner had petrol bombed her previous property. I then find out that her relative had contacted Nick Lowles the very next day after the picture was put online, when she'd become fearful. Contacted Nick Lowles to tell him it wasn't my house. Did he right his wrong? Did he delete the picture? Did he apologise? No, he didn't. Because she's collateral damage. Just as Sharon Claff's collateral damage, just as Ashley's collateral damage, all these people are collateral damage as long as they get to put pressure on the intended victim, on the intended target, which is myself. Now, did this lady in the house have tens of thousands of pounds to take him to court to get her apology? No. If she did, he might have been forced to apologise for his wrongdoing, like he was last time. Now we're seeing multiple women scared in their homes. All the women with children, terrified, targeted, in fear. No one should feel fear in their home, least of all young children. That is what this organisation has been doing. They put a picture of the bedrooms my children sleep in. When they put a picture of my ex-partner's property online, they also put a layout showing the entire layout of the house. So if anyone wants to break in to hurt people, they showed them where the bedrooms are, where the stairs are, where the exits are, where the doors are. Why would they do that? They have targeted my family. Now the difference is, I know where they all live. I know every detail about them. I'm not doxing their addresses, because I understand they have innocent wives, innocent children in their homes, who I very much doubt are even aware of the dangers they're putting many families in. Now the targeting of my children and the photographs of their home, when they know I don't live there, telling everyone that I do, telling everyone it's my house, when they know full well, these are the sorts of threats that I receive on a regular basis.
Oh, you know you're a fucking kid, yeah? You're a fucking kid. You think you're fucking kid, yeah? I'll tell you that, I promise you that. I'm gonna grab your kids and I'll lift them. All right? So I'll just fucking kill you, motherfucker. Okay? But if you're playing it, I hope you're recording this and playing it. Keep on playing it, keep guessing who this cunt is.
Watch what I fucking do to you, you little fucking white bastard. You little porky and cunt, you fucking watch me.
What sort of person listens to those threats? Listens to the intention of Pakistani rape gangs wanting to rape my children? What sort of person attempts to direct them and locate where the family live? They know I don't live there, yet they run an entire article saying it's my home. It's not my home, it's my ex-wife's home. But they're trying to put pressure on me and using my children in the process. Due to the fact now, it's not me in danger, it's not just my children in danger. There's lots of innocent people, and this innocent woman and her daughter, who are now in danger. I made sure I had to locate where Nick Lowles was. I located where he was. I located his wife. I located his family. I would never stoop so low as to give any bit of information that could lead people to that innocent mother and her son's address.
Guy. Yeah, and obviously this was linked. This was a day before my mother's house was smashed up. Mm-hmm. I know this is linked to their if you're making the arrest, the link will be this person making these phone calls linked to their jihadist lawyers.
I know it's 2 months on. I'm thinking, well, if I had phoned someone trying to pervert the course of justice, and threats were made because my ex-wife was terrified, my children were terrified.
Of course.
I just can't understand why there hasn't been an arrest.
Well, I mean, I found out who owned the phone the day I left.
Okay.
So, I mean, obviously I was quite pleased because I wanted to see that through and get those results, because at the moment we just had a number.
On a Friday afternoon, I receive an email from a journalist who's running a story about me with lots of allegations, criminal allegations. Her source of information? Caelan Robertson. Caelan Robertson, who's on camera, who's on tape that you've heard, being blackmailed, sexually abused by these guys in order to create and lie about me. So the man who's paid to lie, who's forced to lie, is then telling stories about me. The mainstream media are ready to pump them to you, the British public. Concerning for me, concerning that my children would read this, she contacts me on a Friday afternoon, gives me till Monday morning at 10 a.m. to answer her allegations. Now what I do with everything is I wanted a video camera to record me giving her proof that this is not a reliable source, that she should not be running this story about me to the British public, because she is fully aware her source has been co-opted, her source has been forced. So I went calmly to her property. Read the headline of what the media told you happened. Now watch the video of what actually happened when I knocked on her door, when I calmly knocked on her door to answer her allegations. On that evening, I was arrested for a breach of the peace. When I got to court, instantly it was kicked out because I didn't breach the peace. I didn't commit a crime. What they then done is the Metropolitan Police Force, who work with these guys, then worked hand in hand with the journalist to get a civil court case against me in order to give me a stalking ban for knocking on the door once. Journalists have terrorised me and my family for a decade. I knocked on the door once, but you don't get told the full story.
I'm here looking for journalist for The Independent, who continually prints lies about me. It's quite nice when you have security and concierge. This is the little bubbles that they live in. They can send other people to your houses, they can harass your families, highlight where you live, and then hide behind their intercom, which is exactly what... Oh, look, they've turned it off. Look, now they're ringing up the security downstairs, you see. They're ringing the security downstairs to say that Tony Robinson's at their door. Which he is, because from what I understand, been trying to contact me. I didn't know how to contact her. They're no one's in their offices now. So I popped down here. And is that? Yes. Yeah, I phoned to him, look, trying to pretend she doesn't live here when I know she lives here. Oh, her partner. Come on. I've apparently your partner's looking for me to answer some questions, so I need to speak to her. She needs to give me my right to reply. Doesn't she? You can't go and print more lies about me without giving me a right to reply. Not when you know they're absolutely made up lies. You're using sources from that you know are lies, are fraudulent. And yet you obviously think it's okay to then write things that my children are going to read.
I'm not even allowed to mention the journalist's name or I'll end up in prison for knocking on her door once, as you've seen. Now, we now have a lady scared in her home due to the actions and the lies of this man and his organisation. I simply cannot go and approach him. But I think the best approach would be to his wife, because she's a mother with a child in her home. And she surely will see the wrong in what her husband is doing. So the lady is scared in her home. I decided that the best idea would be for her, rather than myself, would be for her to approach Nick Lowles' partner to let her know what he's up to.
Well, people,
I don't know what you're
if something
about.
Might be the issue between Tommy Robinson and your partner, your husband. I'm not politically involved. I don't care about Tommy Robinson. I don't care about your husband. That is my girl and myself. My life's now in danger because of this picture that's gone on the internet. Okay. The police are involved. I spoke to the police and they've told me that the best thing is to like try and speak to Nick. I've sent Nick an email, asked him could he take the picture down. He's...
Do you go to the school?
No, my little girl doesn't go to this school at all. So I've sent Nick an email, you can confirm it with him, and I've asked him please take it down. I've had no response. My domestic violence officer has already said that she's going to approach Nick as well, but I'm not getting any that route. So I'm just asking you as a mum, could you please ask him just to take the picture down for me and let him know that this is nothing to do with me. I've rent
and I'd prefer you if you, you know, yeah.
And I didn't want to approach you when you had your children with you because, no. Like, as a mum, I don't think that's fair either.
No.
But just as a mum,
have you come from Bedford?
Yes. Yeah. I've drove from Bedford so that I could speak to you myself.
What's your surname?
Yeah, but if I give you that, then I get into trouble.
Okay, fine. All right.
That's all I'm saying. All right. You know, I don't want Nick coming at me.
Leave it with me.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I do appreciate it, honestly.
Okay. Can you give me a screenshot of the picture?
Yes,
the
I will do. Yeah.
Can you just show me
something? Right. I've left my phone in my car. You wait right here. I'll go and get my phone.
I don't want to do it too much in front of.
Yeah,
other
that's
people.
What I'm thinking. Yeah. If you go on his Hope Not Hate website,
right,
and it says Tommy Robbins extra houses, or and it's a full-on picture of my house,
yeah,
in Silso. He's given the complete description of where
Silso.
My house.
In Silso?
Yeah.
Okay, right, leave it with me.
And he's given the complete... I've had to have cameras secured around my house now because I've had four Asians turn up at my car screaming, "Where's Tommy?" banging on my doors. But my little girl is terrified.
Okay.
I'm terrified.
Leave it with me, okay? Leave it with me.
I'm so sorry to have to do this to you, but...
No, don't. I don't.
It's just so hard. Yeah. You know, I'm already fleeing domestic violence.
So you...
Now, that was Nick Lowell's wife. I'm not going to show who she is. We have images of her, recordings of her. I'm not going to show who she is or where she lives. I don't want her to feel fear in her home. That's the total opposite to what these guys are doing to us. They actively seek and target our families. They hope and they try and direct violence towards us. They try to dox our addresses, say we live in houses we don't because our family live in those houses. They are actively targeting our children, our partners, our mothers, our families. I'm not going to do that to his wife. Luckily, his wife seemed like a very nice lady and she saw the total wrong in what her partner was doing. Because within just hours of the lady who he falsely accused was my home approaching his wife, this happened.
Hello, Colette.
What's the matter?
They have deleted the pictures of your house.
Wow.
They're gone.
So that worked then?
Yeah, they're gone. So it was the best, because you see, if I'd have turned up at their house, it would have gone a totally different way.
Oh, that's such good news, mate. At least it's worked.
Yeah. So, you happy?
Brilliant. Well, that's good, mate.
I hope now. I'm going to try and search in there and see if there's anyone else that archived it and saved the pictures or the location. But the main point, of course, was obviously from them and they've erased it. So.
Fantastic.
All right.
That's excellent, honey.
Cool. All right.
Okay,
bye-bye.
Timing is important and you have to understand what's happened in a 1 week period. Men have turned up looking for me. I'm receiving phone call after phone call, death threats every day. Yeah? They've turned up at another lady's house, which you've heard, four of them looking for me again. I receive a threat, which has all been made online. So these guys have watched all of this. My family receive threats that people are going to kidnap and rape my daughters. They're going to drug them from school. What does this organisation do? That week, after hearing all of that, they give my address. Someone is hired to visit the family home where my ex-wife and children are in alone at 11 p.m. to shine a torch through their door. That's what they do that week. Listen to this.
Right. We've told you before, don't come to our fucking house.
I didn't go to that house.
You've been to our house before?
Not that house. I've never
her house.
I have never been to that house.
But you've been to her house?
Yeah, again.
And you know that's
I went to a house where they told me.
Who's they?
Right. Let me give you this. I promise you, I'm totally on the level.
Well, on the level,
yeah,
how are you going to feel when I come to your house at 11 o'clock at night? How's that feel?
I promise
you. Have you got kids in your house? Have you got kids in your house?
They've grown up and gone.
Is it right for me to turn up at your house at 11 o'clock at night?
No, it would be silly.
And start taking pictures of your house?
It would be silly. I appreciate
that. So what are you taking pictures of my fucking kids' house for?
Right. What they told me, yeah, the instruction was, that's That's me, the Mendes Legal Service. I'm a process serving company.
Fallowfield Stevenage.
Yeah, that's just the office. Right, what they said to me was, I had to bring the papers out here to you. It's very important you got them, yeah? I'm just a delivery boy, yeah? They said, if he's not there, leave him there. But if you leave, you see, what I'm meant to do with papers, I'm meant to make sure you get them. So say, here you go, these are for you, yeah?
This is who you are, yeah?
I'm Mark, yeah.
Right? You're Mark DaCosta.
Yeah, I'm Mark DaCosta. But if I can't get them to you, just to show that they were... I take a picture. You see, I took a picture of the papers.
No, you didn't. You took a picture of
the
children's home.
No, I can, yeah, I can, if I could find my phone, I could show it to you. I've lost my bloody phone. I could show you. I just put the paper on the floor. I took a picture of it. That's all. That's what I have to do. I'm nothing to do with anything.
Who are you delivering for?
Who's giving you this address? I moved because you come to my last house.
I was
told you, he does not live with me. No, leave me and my children alone.
I'm right. Are you happy to talk in front of...
Who's this from?
These are solicitors. Brought the papers. I've nothing to do with these solicitors.
So you, who do you work for?
I work for myself. I'm a processor. Basically, I'm a pro. You can use me. If you've got someone you want to...
Who sent you here? That's a simple question.
They did. The solicitors.
Which solicitors?
It's on the paperwork. I don't know. Right. But basically, they give me all the information. I'm not the postman, yeah, bringing a British Gas job. I don't know what it's about. I don't know how British Gas got your address. They just say, Mark.
It's not my address.
No, exactly, anything. But I'm just given that address. That's all I'm given, I promise you. I don't know why, when, who, and my job is to just make sure they get there.
So you think it's normal?
No, I don't.
So did they tell you to come at 11 o'clock at night?
Yes. I've been out working all evening, and I said, I can't go, it's late. It's like, you know, I'd normally never go after about 9 o'clock. Yeah, but they said, no, you've got to go now. I've been up since 3 o'clock this morning.
So they've told you to come.
They've told me to come. Just come here now and get them to you.
To my children's house.
Yeah, and they said, if you weren't in, because I think you said he's not in, they're fine.
Doesn't live there.
No, that's right, yeah. Leave him there. Don't get me wrong. I think it's stupid too. I think it's really ridiculous.
Do you normally get told to go to house at 11 o'clock at night?
Very rarely, I'll give you that.
We had so much more. This hasn't been put together and finished the way I would have wanted it finished as a documentary for you, as professional as it should, because we've rushed it. Why have I had to rush it? Listen to this.
Hope Not Hate is under attack. As you will probably know, at the beginning of this year, we helped facilitate the takeover of the investigation into Tommy Robinson's alleged bankruptcy. Last year, Tommy Robinson declared himself bankrupt in order to avoid paying hundreds of thousands of pounds in court fees and damages from a libel case that he lost against a Syrian refugee. As a consequence of our investigation, and as a consequence of our repeated exposés of his assets, he and his associates have gone on the attack against us. They have been watching our houses. They have been confronting us and family members out in the streets. They've gone to the police with all sorts of stupid and malicious stories against us. They've done all this in order to intimidate us, to harass us, and ultimately to silence us. But we will not be silenced. We will not be bullied, and we will not back down. We are asking you to support this crowdfunder so we have the tools and the assets to fight back. We need to increase security in our houses. We need to employ lawyers to take on Tommy Robinson and Paul Golding and their lies. And we need more money to carry on our investigations. We are all in on this now. We will not back down and we will expose their wrongdoing. Please support us and please support us in stopping them bullying and harassing us.
In his appeal for security, he's raised over £50,000. He's under attack. He's under attack. Look at what you've seen. Look at the targeting of families in their homes. Who's under attack here? But he betrays himself, twists it full 360, betrays himself. He's got all the, under that link, politicians, journalists, they're all commenting, are you okay, Nick? Poor Nick. Poor Nick. This man. That's what's going on. So we've rushed this film because I am aware now that he is working with the Metropolitan Police Force to attempt to get an injunction, just like they managed to get with the previous journalist, an injunction to prevent me showing you any of this. So we've worked fast to get it out, to beat their injunction. When I produced my Panorama documentary, which proved Nick Lowell's involvement with Hope Not Hate and with Caelan Robertson and with Panorama, the Panorama show was cancelled, John Sweeney lost his job, and the BBC got dirty hands. Since then, Nick Lowell continues to work with filmmakers, documentary makers, and journalists. But he steps away.
It's not in-house. The BBC dispatches, they outsource it to independent film companies that then work with Nick Lowles. That's to prevent them getting the dirty hands that they got last time. But the ploy and the plots, they continue. Now, with his new book coming out, and with the media sitting, guaranteed waiting to run the headlines of their lies, I need to speak to Nick. I need to see how many more sources have been created for their lies. I also need to put these allegations to him from the evidence that you've heard. Last and final stop, let's go speak to Nick Lowles.
Nick, how many people have you paid? How many sources have you created to give false information? How many people have you paid to lie? You give drugs to Tom Foley. Drugs to Tom Foley. Why do you give drugs to Tom Foley? How many different people have you paid to lie? Why don't you stop and talk, Nick? You create sources of information. You create your source of information and then you use the media to run them and pump your lies. Why would you, Caelan Robertson, why was you blackmailing him? What was you doing travelling out to Italy to see him? What was you doing, Nick? You got no answer. Don't you have an answer?
Should we talk about your crimes and your activities?
Let's talk, come on, why not? Where are you walking to?
I'm going to work.
Going to work? You're going to create more sources. What about Danny Tomo's ex-missus? Why did you tell her he slept with an underage victim? Why did you lie to her? Why have you told her that? Why were you paying her sister money? Do you understand that when you pay someone, they're no longer a reliable source of information because they're being paid by you? Are you going to deny paying people? Are you going to deny creating sources, Nick? You're going to deny creating sources. Get around the front. How many people in your book have been paid to lie about me? How many sources have you created in your book with your money? Huh? Answer the question. You do realise that paying someone, they're not a reliable source once you've paid them, blackmailed them. What about Andrew Edge? You're going to deny you've met Andrew Edge?
No, I'm not going to deny I met Andrew Edge.
So you have met Andrew Edge? Are you going to deny you was meeting?
It's pretty obvious we've met Andrew Edge.
Are you going to deny you was meeting with... Have you paid Danny Tomo's missus' sister? Have you given money to Danny Tomo's missus' sister? Bearing in mind, I have evidence you have.
So?
I have evidence you have.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, what about your source of information? So you're doing it again. You created Caelan Robertson. You created Andrew Edge. You created Tom Foley. You created Danny Tomo's missus' sister. Well, no, it's not boring, because you're destroying lives by creating false. You're creating false
Says
information.
Says the drug dealer.
Says the drug dealer. Yeah. Are you calling me a drug dealer?
Yeah.
Who have I dealt with? Will you deny that you've been paying Danny Tomo's ex's sister to say things about him? Are you going to deny that?
I'm not talking about anyone I might have
spoken you're not,
to.
Yeah, because you're not going to deny it. You contacted Jasmine Bishop. You told her that he slept with an underage victim. That's what you told her. You lied to her to get her on your side. You got her angry. You got her angry so she would say things.
I didn't need to lie to her at all.
Did you say to her that Danny Tomo slept with an underage victim?
Find out in my book. You'll find out what my allegations are in my book.
Allegations are only that because you pay people. No. As we found out, you've been paying people. When you pay someone, you can't run a source in your book making allegations when you're paying them to say it. That doesn't work like that. It's not a reliable source of information.
Find out what my book
says. No, because your book is full of sources that you've created with money, blackmail, drugs.
One more question. Father to father, do you think it's fair that you put a picture of my children's home online when you know people want to kill them and rape them?
No one's identified that home.
No, you put a picture of my children's home online. You have. Yeah?
And you doorstepped my partner.
No, I didn't doorstep my partner.
Your people did.
No, not my people.
Really?
The woman who was scared in her home doorstepped your partner because you put a picture of her home online and then turned up there looking for me, which you're aware of because she contacted you. Multiple times. You didn't take her house down. Why did you take it down once your wife told you to take it down? Why did you then delete the picture of her house? Because you know it was wrong, Nick. You play dirty tricks and you try and put targets on
dirty
people's houses.
Tricks.
Sharon Clough.
Dirty
Explain
tricks.
What happened with Sharon Clough.
Dirty what did
you say? You create sources.
Really?
I've got evidence of seven sources you've created. You pay them.
When that story
you blackmail
comes out,
them.
When that story
you pay
comes
them,
out.
You blackmail them. I know you've got the media waiting to run your stories.
Yeah,
I know you have. Because that's what your job is. Your job is to create the source, create a lie, and then the media wait there and pump it.
Yeah.
That's what you do.
Fine.
And I'm exposing you for it in a documentary. No one's going to trust you. No one's going to trust your source.
You
can't talk like you're a hero for women. You scared a woman in her house so much she had to come crying to your missus. You scared her in her home with her little 12-year-old daughter. They're still scared now because of your actions. Okay? You intimidated Ashley and her little boy. He's not allowed to play outside. You put a picture of my kids up in my kids' home. I know how it feels because my kids are scared because of your actions. So don't talk to me about women because you scared women. Sharon Clough got beaten up. She's an old age pensioner. She got attacked because of you.
Shit. Okay,
you're chatting
fine,
shit.
Fine,
you're creating a source.
Fine.
You're paying someone.
Fine.
You're paying, and, and I've got evidence of it.
Fine.
Every step
sure
of the way.
Sure, and I've got lots of evidence as well.
No, you haven't. You've got sources that you've paid.
Why have you turned up today?
Nick, I've been working on this for months.
I know you have.
Yeah, I've been working on it for months.
Yeah.
Months.
Yeah.
I'm exposing how you create your sources.
Right.
No journalist should ever trust you again.
Really?
But then they don't. They know what you're doing. You're all working hand in hand. As you just said, you've got the media waiting to run your stories.
No, you told me that.
You write the stories for them.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're part of the deep state, Nick.
Yeah.
You paid Tom Foley.
Uh-huh.
What, yeah? Are you going to deny paying him? You paid Andrew Edge. You create your sources of information.
Better than dealing drugs, though, isn't it?
Now, I've cut 30 minutes down, but I want you to be able to listen to his answer to each of the allegations. So listen to this.
I know you've got the media waiting to run your stories.
Yeah,
I know you have.
I
know you have. Because that's what your job is. Your job is to create the source, create a lie, and then the media wait there and pump it.
Yeah.
You contacted Jasmine Bishop. You told her that he slept with an underage victim. That's what you told her. You lied to her to get her on your side. You got her angry. You got her angry so she would say
things. I didn't need to lie to her at all.
Did you say to her that he slept with an underage girl? Did you say to her? Will you deny that you've been paying Danny Tomo's ex's sister to say things about him? Are you going to deny that?
I'm talking about anyone I might have
spoken because you're not going to deny it.
Will you deny?
What about Andrew Edge? You're going to deny you've met Andrew Edge?
No, I'm not going to deny I met Andrew Edge.
So you have met Andrew Edge? Are you going to deny you've met?
It's pretty obvious we've met Andrew Edge.
Are you going to deny? You paid Tom Foley.
Uh-huh.
What, yeah? Are you going to deny paying him? You paid Andrew Edge. You create your sources of information.
Better than dealing drugs, though, isn't it?
This is no longer about accusations from Tommy Robinson. It's no longer about the covert recordings, whether it be of Tom Foley, Andrew Edge, or whoever else you've heard from. We now have it from the horse's mouth. I want you to listen one more time and get the confirmation, because he admits it all. He confirms it. Listen one more time.
You paid Tom Foley.
Uh-huh.
What, yeah? Are you going to deny paying him? You paid Andrew Edge. You create your sources of information.
Better than dealing drugs, though, isn't it?
A drug dealer? Really? Come on. Even you people that don't like me. I've been accused of lots of things before, but Nick, a drug dealer? A racist hasn't worked, extremist hasn't worked, Islamophobe hasn't worked. I know, I'm that desperate, I'm getting questioned, I'm getting exposed. You're a drug dealer! He does not care. He's that comfortable with what he's been doing. Yeah, so? Yeah, I did. It's not as bad as drug dealing. What? He's admitted and accepted the criminality he's been involved in. Now, what we're looking at is women scared in their homes. To the politicians, to people watching this, trade unionists, politicians, journalists, the actual journalists who care about journalism. I'm presenting this to you. I haven't presented anything that's not backed up with evidence. Now, I know I'm not perfect. I know I have a past and I have a history. I'm also aware that I'm not the moral example for everyone to follow. I've had my flaws. But this documentary has been put together to expose to you, if you care about democracy, if you care about free speech, criminal organisations like this must be stopped. Journalists sit waiting hand in hand with these guys. These guys create their sources. You are lying to the British public. The next time you watch a documentary, whether it be Panorama, Dispatches, the next time you read a newspaper and it involves these guys, you know you can question everything, because you know you're being fooled and you're being lied to. We've had a mole on the inside of Hope Not Hate for over 12 months. Someone that's worked with them for nearly a decade, feeding us back information about their wrongdoings, about how they conduct their so-called investigation.
Yeah, well, they all do that. I mean, they're all quite, like, you know, I mean, I've been into this guy for about 10 years.
Yeah.
10 years, Tommy, and you know, sometimes, like, you know, I mean, regular contact. What he wants to do is, he wants to just cripple you, like, financially, forever, so you can't do anything.
Just to prove to you all the legitimacy of our mole, Nick Lowell's released his first ever image of the front cover of his new book called Tommy, coming soon on the 10th of the 7th, 2022. More than a week before that, here's an image of the front cover of his book on my phone on the 30th of the 6th, 2022, which I received from his mole, Rob.
But it didn't. And then I've just spoken to him today, not today, yesterday, and that's when he sent me that picture. And he said to me, don't put it out. And then he said he's going to drop it over the weekend. And then he turned around and he just, with a book, you know, basically there's a deadline and he's got to get it in now. So he's, it hasn't even gone to print.
But what's the story of the book? What's he, what is his story?
Oh, the book, well, it's just, it goes through. It's just about you, how you started. Yeah. So it goes all the way back to the UDL days.
Yep.
Who was involved and then what's been going on since then. But he can write what he wants. I mean, all he's got to do is back it up with people.
At making allegations. Yeah, so he'll meet people. Someone will say, yeah, he'll get someone or pay someone to say anything. And then he'll run a story.
But that's what he's been doing.
What's he been doing?
He's been getting people.
Yeah.
That maybe that were in the old EDL, or people that are around today, or people that he's met or known, or people that he's contacted.
Our suspicions about Hope Not Hate creating sources was confirmed very early on.
Yeah. So that's it. So you know that all this information that's coming, it's coming from people that have never been close to you.
And people that hate me.
And people that hate you, yeah. What they've never been in the inner circle.
What a rat.
You know, so the, you know, and it's, well, the reason why he's done this, and I know why, he's done it for legal reasons, because he can't put anything in his book.
Yeah, that's, he has to have true. Someone saying it, so he's gone and got him on tape saying it, and then he'll write it.
That's, yeah.
About everything, so he'll have someone saying, I done this, I done that, yeah. and then he can write it.
And he's covered his arse.
And he'll just say a source close to him.
Yeah.
A source who was with him.
Yeah.
A source who was there says this.
Yep.
Tramp.
Yeah, and that's how it's done.
Now just listen to his associate tell us how low this man will go in his quest to destroy me.
So I know he was in Luton quite a lot recently, and that was to do with needed information for his book. So he was met, I know he met with a couple of the Gambinos, or what's left of them. I know he met a couple of those up there. He met some other people from Luton.
And what can he possibly get off them?
What, the Gambinos?
Yeah. Going to meet in a heroin dealing gang.
They're all in jail, ain't they?
Going to meet in a heroin dealing gang to get him. What? Oh, they're going to have some. A heroin dealing Muslim gang from Luton. Yeah, they're going to have something good to say about me, ain't they?
The Gambinos. Let me show you who the Gambinos are. This is a national newspaper's article from 2009. Asian terror gangs target UK with killer heroin. Let me just read some extracts from this. One of the Asian gangs is the so-called Gambino clan, a 100-strong mob named after notorious US crime family. The Gambinos are the Pakistani Muslim gang that control most of the drug trade in Luton, and they've all got good connections to Al-Qaeda. Nick Lowles is travelling to Luton to meet heroin-dealing gangs who have great connections to Al-Qaeda. They fund terrorist organisations, and that is who Nick Lowles is travelling, having meetings with, to get them as a source of information against me. And just for the record, I first made an article about the Gambino gang. It's in my Oxford Union speech, where I addressed who they are, said they're using heroin to drug and pimp our daughters. I'd done that when I was 20 years old in Luton. They have hated me for years. Who does he go? You're going to see his source of information in his book with all his allegations against me. You now know who his source of information is. Being aware of his meeting with the Gambinos, when I got the chance to discuss it with Nick Lowles, I put these allegations to him.
It will come out soon.
Who are you making that accusation against? Oh, you've created soon. Sources. I've heard you were in paying the Gambinos in Luton.
Have I?
I've heard you've met and paid Pakistani gangs in Luton.
Really?
Yes.
Really?
Creating more sources of information, Nick. Creating more sources of information.
Yeah.
But you create the source.
I look forward to it.
You create your source. So you'll have a source that you've paid. You've gone in. Because I know you've been meeting Pakistani gangs in Luton.
Really?
You'll be paying them. Say this, really? Say this, say this. I've got the evidence of it.
Who?
I've got the evidence of members of your team telling me that.
Who?
Members of your team tell me
really?
That. I had the front cover of your book weeks ago, you clown.
Yeah, yeah.
You clown. Right? Yeah. I had the front cover of your book. I had the fact you were meeting Gambinos. I've got the screenshots and messages of it. Gambinos are a heroin dealing gang in Luton.
And you know all about them.
And you've gone and approached them.
And you know
you've gone
all
and paid them.
Them.
I grew up
in Luton. I've challenged them for years. Yeah. My 2004 leaflet names them. Yeah. It names them as heroin dealer.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you've gone and met them and paid them to say things about them. So you're a scumbag.
Have you ever sold cocaine?
No, I haven't. No.
Really?
No.
Okay.
I haven't. You're a scumbag. See, look. So now we know. So you've got people you're paying to make these allegations so you can run with the headlines.
Yeah.
After confronting Nick Lowles about him meeting the Gambinos, he's aware someone's talking to us within his team. He then contacts our mole. You might not be talking to TR, but you are talking to Hell. Hell's my PA. Strange that something I only told you was brought up by Lennon today. He's aware. Yeah? He's figured out who our mole is. Listen to this.
This is Hope Not Hate, dude.
Hello, mate. How are you?
Not bad, Rob. You?
Fucking a bit stressed, to be honest with you, mate. You know, it's all coming to an end, isn't it? It's all coming to a head now, isn't it? So eventually he's going to know, you know, what I've been up to, so...
As we've seen, in order to destroy me and target me, our mole makes it very clear what Nick Lowles' ambition is.
What he's hoping to do is to get your missus into court.
Yeah. Okay.
That's really what he wants to do, and put her under pressure.
How does he think he's...
As you've seen, not content with sitting down with heroin gangs, or paying people, or bribing people, or sexual assaults, he wants to target the mother of my children, my ex-wife. When I approached Nick Lowles outside his house, it became very apparent that one of their main targets is Daniel Thomas. Daniel Thomas is an ex-colleague of mine. But to destroy him is to discredit me, which become very apparent after talking to Nick Lowles.
Danny Tomo's missus' sister. Have you given money to Danny Tomo's missus' sister? Bear in mind, I have evidence you have.
So?
I have evidence you have.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, what about Danny Tomo's missus?
You show your evidence and I'll show my evidence.
What about Danny Tomo's missus?
What? The one who was beaten up by Danny Tomo?
A lot of the allegations about Danny Tomo were about him and his ex-partner. But the allegations didn't seem to have become him from his ex-partner. They seem to be coming from other sources that no doubt Nick Lowles has created. The first thing Nick Lowles told Danny Tomo's ex-partner when he spoke to her, they had just had a very severe breakup, finished on bad terms. Now I know straight away, that means he's gonna get in contact. I know that, because that's what he does with everyone and has done for 15 years. But the first thing he tells her is that Danny Tomo has been sleeping with an underage victim of sexual exploitation. A total fabricated lie. The intention to anger his ex-partner, to get her on side, then out comes the money. We find out that he's been paying her sister, who doesn't have a very good relationship with Danny Tomo either. He's been paying her.
So you're willing to accept, yeah? So you're telling me you got paid by this journalist to talk shit for 20 minutes? How much did he pay you, Kane? How much did he pay you, Kane? How much did he pay you?
I don't have to confirm nothing to you.
I know how much he paid you. Jazz told me, £300, and she got half.
Yeah? Is that right? Is that all? All right, that's what Jazz got, yeah.
When Jasmine was made aware of the allegations being made by Nick, or one of his new created sources, she attempted to call Nick over 25 times, but he refused to answer, probably hiding under his bed, awaiting the release of this documentary. Here was her voice recording, which she left for him.
Nick, I've tried to call you now multiple times and you are not answering my phone call. I know why, because you don't hear what I've got to say. Firstly, let me just get this straight in case you do not understand. Danny has never put me in hospital. Danny has never beaten me up. The pictures that you have seen have got nothing to do with Danny at all. Secondly, you've paid my little sister, who hates Danny more than anything in the world, to talk shit about Danny. Thirdly, you came into my life and you told me that there was a video going around of my baby dad with a 15-year-old girl. You made me feel physically sick. You've mentally abused my brain into thinking that my baby dad is a paedophile when that's not true. You didn't even come back and tell me that it wasn't true. You just told other people. If you do not leave me and my sister alone, I will be seeking legal advice. I'll be doing that anyway because this is draining me so much. It's affecting me mentally and physically, and I've actually had enough.
Every person you've seen that Hope Not Hate contact and used then as a negative source, not just against myself, but against anyone with activism. There's another gentleman here I'm going to introduce you to. Speaker's Corner Steve. He's an activist at Speaker's Corner. Listen to the words he has to say about me.
This man. And I have no shame in saying I agree with every word Tommy Robinson has ever said. And I have no shame. I have no shame on that. Tommy Robinson has bigger balls than all of you put together.
And that's why. Absolutely.
Now, over the last 3 to 4 months, there's been a lot of negative comments coming out of Steve, which has surprised me totally. I believed it was because he aligned himself with Reform, a political party, and was trying to distance himself from us. But then I saw this video with these allegations.
It's my voice.
Are we allowed to talk about Tommy grifting?
No one grifts around here. We have no grifters. No drug dealers. No scammers.
A totally new allegation. I'm a drug dealer, apparently, yeah? You've heard it from Nick Lowles. And now I've heard it from Speaker's Corner Steve. So it's a new allegation. What possibly could have changed him from supporting me and being close to me and just 3-4 months ago totally turned against me and throwing out the same accusations that Nick Lowles is now throwing out? That's where our source and our mole has been so valuable.
I mean, as I understand it, I mean, listen, I'm just going to give you something else, yeah?
Go on.
Get Steve off of your groups.
Steve, Speaker's Corner?
Yeah, get him off all your groups.
Is he working right, mate?
He's met him.
How long ago did he meet?
To him.
How long ago did he meet?
I'd say he's been probably messaging probably the last 3-4 months.
Which is when he turned against us.
Yeah, so, but get him. He's still in a few of your groups. Don't put it out though, do it discreetly, Tommy.
Okay.
You know, but they're still, they message each other and that, and I know that I talk to Steve, and I know, like, you know, I mean, when I get a message from Lowles like that one, I know he's just got off the phone to Lowles, or, you know, so.
Steve, so Speaker's Corner Steve's working with Nick Lowles, and that's been for 3-4 months. That makes sense. All makes sense, mate. All makes sense. I decided to ring Steve and see what he's got to say for himself.
Hello.
Hi, Steve. It's Tommy Robinson.
Hello there.
Steve, I have evidence that you've been in regular contact with Nick Lowles from Hope Not Hate.
Do you? How would you have that?
I have it, mate. So when was the first time you started getting in contact with him, Steve?
Why?
Just want to see what your relationship is with him and how long it's been going on.
Why is that?
Well, because you've totally gone on an attack and totally changed, and it seems to be, from the timing I've been given, since you've become a regular contact with Nick Lowles.
What is your
relationship with Nick Lowles? When did you start having contact with Nick Lowles?
I've also watched
a video of you making allegations that I'm a drug dealer.
Have you not ever been?
No. So why would you be throwing that out, that I'm a drug dealer?
Multiple sources. It's a common statement.
Multiple sources.
You must be aware of that.
Only you and Nick Lowles. So that's what I'm wondering. Where's the source? What's your multiple sources that I'm a drug dealer?
Multiple people have told me.
Okay.
It's the common rumour out on the street.
Coming from?
Multiple people.
Such
multiple
as?
Sources. That you're not aware of it yourself.
Such as? So what you're saying is, I've watched you make the accusation, you've said I'm a drug dealer.
Have you never been? Have you never done that? Have you never, in your entire existence, sold an item of drugs?
No, I haven't. No. So as I'll ask you again, you're making a serious accusation against me. You've put it out online. Yeah. You've said I'm a drug dealer. I'm asking you.
I said lots of other things about you. Are you going to question me on those other things too?
I will. Yeah, but we'll start on the drug dealer one because it's the same accusation that's coming from Nick Lowles, and I find out you're in regular contact with Nick Lowles, just on the phone to him.
You found out I'd been in regular contact with Nick Lowles. I mean, what, you're demanding me for sources of evidence. What's your source of evidence for that?
Someone within Hope Not Hate, Nick. Someone within Hope Not Hate, buddy. Don't worry, I've got
it. Anyway, I've got a meeting at 12 o'clock. I can't carry on. Maybe call me back later if you want to continue this conversation.
So you don't have a source. I'm a drug dealer. You're just putting it out there. You're just putting it out there. The same thing that Nick Lowles is putting out there, and you're meeting with him.
Obviously, I've included the recordings, the covert recordings of me talking with my source over many months, yeah? Within Hope Not Hate, my mole. But the reason I've done that is because he's been outed. They know he's been in cooperation with me. Yeah? This is the last message Nick Lowles sent to him just yesterday, once Nick Lowles knows he's been outed. And he began crying. Don't you fucking dare tell me to step back and not make it personal. It is fucking personal. And I'm going after Tommy and everyone who stands with him. And then he says he's lost the plot. He sounds like an emotional wreck. So Nick's been outed. He knows what's coming. And these are more threats. Because what does this mean? This means he's going to work with the British state. He's going to work with the establishment, probably work with the police. They're going to attempt to destroy us even further than they already have. With their lies, manipulation, their criminal behaviour. Now let's just look again and ask ourselves a question. There's a list of people who have been close to myself, close to other activists at different times, very close, and then full 360 turned, gone on the attack. What have Caelan Robertson, Jim Dowson, Jada Franson, Andrew Edge, Tom Foley, Steve from Speaker's Corner. What has every one of these people got in common? Hope, not hate. But more worryingly, who else are they targeting? Who else is working with them? You'll see, because you'll maybe see the people coming out against us or slandering us. Now, a particularly nasty speciality of Hope, not hate is the targeting of women and vulnerable women at that. Listen to another last recording from our mole within Hope My Hate.
Oh, well, that's why most people, yeah.
People fall out of me and then they just, and he recruits them and they tell him what he wants to hear.
Yeah, yeah, the same thing what happened with Lucy Brown. I mean, what happened with Lucy Brown, as soon as that all that shit happened with Lucy Brown,
yeah,
is that they approached her because they knew she was vulnerable.
Hope My Hate did, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and it's because she was like she is.
At that time, Lucy was vulnerable, which is when they strike. I'm not making the allegations Lucy's done anything wrong. Hope Not Hate have tried to coerce her at a vulnerable time in her life. Just say, as they have Danny Tomo's ex-missus as well. They had a relationship breakdown, a severe breakup, and instep Hope Not Hate. They also targeted Danny Tomo's ex-missus' sister. All three of these women at that time were vulnerable. But let's look at the other women that they've targeted in their home. Whether it be the female whose property they put up with, who lived with her 12-year-old daughter, who was terrified in her home after the targeting. Or it'd be Sharon Claff, an old grandmother who was violently beaten and attacked because of their lies. Or Ashley and her children, now scared in their home, having to fortify it. Even the mother of my children, my ex-wife, who they've targeted her property, purposely doing it time and time again. Or even my mother and father, who are old age pensioners, who should be able to enjoy peace in their home. Their target every time is to target vulnerable people and families. As we end this documentary, Hope Not Hate are currently under criminal investigation by three separate police forces, including Greater Manchester Police. To the publishers of Nick Lowles' book that he's bringing out, and to the documentaries that are currently working with him, how many sources do you think he's used in these publications where the media are waiting to run the stories that he's blackmailed, sexually assaulted, given drugs to, paid £20,000? How many of them have been intimidated, paid or coerced? Question everything. To Hope Not Hate, this isn't the end. Our expose will continue.